Hello, my name is Matt Howard. I'm a smart contract developer for Chia, and today I'm going to be taking you through an overview of developing applications on Chia. Firstly, I want to stress that it's okay to pause this video, to rewind, and rewatch it multiple times until you feel comfortable with the material. After that, if you have any questions, we'll be doing a live Q&A, and if you missed the live Q&A, then feel free to ask us questions on Keybase. With that said, let's move on to the first and most important lesson of Chia. Chia is not Ethereum. In Ethereum, smart contracts are objects that exist on the blockchain that you can interact with. Chia doesn't support this. Instead, we use a coin model where the coins themselves have the code inside and you interact with coins. The program that is inside of a coin is called its puzzle, and there are no unsmart spends of Chia coins. You always have to run that puzzle that's inside the coin. Anybody can try to spend the coin, so it's up to the puzzle to secure the intended behavior. One common misunderstanding that I see is that this means that we don't support statefulness. This is incorrect. The coins themselves are state. The puzzle inside a coin represents state. You just have to design around coins being the primary object. I'll get a little bit more into how this works practically in a little bit. But for now, think of the example of tokens. In Ethereum, these would be ERC tokens. But in Ethereum, what you're actually doing is interacting with a contract that keeps track of who has what tokens. Whereas in Chia, the coins themselves are tokens. They contain the tokenness inside them. This is just one example of the kind of graceful design that Chia enables. With that very important lesson out of the way, I'm now going to move on to the rest of the video. Today, I'll be covering how everything connects, sort of an overview, and some of the questions I want to address are: what is happening when you spend a coin? When and where is Chialisp code run? And how do I get started making cool stuff? Hopefully you'll have some good ideas about all of these by the end of this video. There's a number of technologies all interacting together. At the bottom of this stack is CLVM. This is the small compressed language which runs on the Chia blockchain. There's an expanded version of CLVM, which is called Chialisp. This has extra operators and features and will compile down into CLVM. You can think of the relationship between Chialisp and CLVM as sort of like the relationship between C and assembly. When you run a Chialisp program, it gets passed a set of arguments, which we call the solution. So you have the puzzle and you have the solution. You can think about writing Chialisp puzzles like writing functions in other programming languages, where the solution would then be the parameters that are passed in. As I mentioned before, coins contain puzzles, but more specifically, they contain the hash of the puzzle because it's a smaller fixed size. They also contain their parent's identity and an amount of value that they're currently holding. The ID of a coin is defined by the hash of the parent ID, puzzle hash, and amount concatenated together. The value of amount is represented in Mojo, not Chia. Mojos are comparable to Satoshis in Bitcoin, but they represent 1/1,000,000,000th of a Chia. New coins are created when a block is farmed, and when they're created this way, they are locked up with the puzzle hash that is a part of the farmer's plots. Once a coin has been created, it can then create other coins by running the puzzle that's inside it. But how do you actually spend a coin? To spend a coin, you must reveal the full puzzle, corresponding to the puzzle hash locked inside the coin, and attach a solution. These are stored inside of a spend bundle object. A spend bundle contains the ID of the coin that you want to spend, the puzzle reveal, the solution, and an aggregated signature. Chia uses BLS signatures, which are aggregatable. This means that if you have signature A and signature B, you can aggregate them to create signature C. Signature C will then verify if there is a check for both signature A and signature B. This means that we can aggregate spend bundles together to contain multiple coin spends with a single aggregated signature. When you send a spend bundle off to the blockchain, it will get shared around so that when a farmer wins a new block, they can include it onto the blockchain. A farmer that receives the spend bundle will ask a few questions. Does the coin that's trying to be spent actually exist? Does the puzzle reveal match the hash inside of the coin? Does the spend fail during runtime? What are the conditions returned by the spend? And do the conditions pass? The conditions are a defined interface to allow puzzles to communicate with the blockchain. The programs inside coins are dumb and do not know about where they are running or what the state of the blockchain is, but they can assert things to be true using conditions. If puzzles are like functions in other languages, the conditions language is what gets returned by that function. Most of the conditions work by asserting this transaction is only valid if this condition is true. However, you can also create coins using the conditions language, and they work by saying if this transaction is otherwise valid, then create the following coins. This is fundamentally how coins and puzzles communicate with the blockchain. Some examples of conditions would be assert that my amount is 200. Assert that the current block height is greater than 3008. We have a full list of the conditions available on the Chialisp.com documentation website. Let's put this into practice. Let's imagine Alice wants to write a new smart contract that acts as a piggy bank, so she can only cash out if she's reached her savings goal. We would write a puzzle that can be spent in two ways, depositing money or withdrawing money. Let's take a look at the pseudocode in Python for what that would look like. Here, the function code is acting as the puzzle and the parameters are acting as the solution. Remember, coins don't actually know anything about themselves. So if you want to say something about your puzzle hash or your amount, you must pass it in the solution and then assert that those things are true using the conditions language. You can see this in action here, where we pass in the puzzle hash and the amount and assert that they are my puzzle hash and my amount. This code will check which spending mode you want based on the solution, check that the new amount is bigger than the old amount, and then create a new coin with your puzzle and the new amount locked up inside it. If you're trying to deposit, it will check that your current amount is greater than the savings that you want to make, and if it is, then it will let you create a new coin with any puzzle hash and any amount that you want. Now here is that same code again, but written in Chialisp. You may have noticed in the last slide that we used raise for invalid cases. This is because when you're writing a puzzle, there are some states that you want to assert cannot be reached. For example here, if the new amount is less than the old amount, we want that to instantly fail. So we use X to designate instant failure inside of the puzzle. We'll go into more detail about how Chialisp works later, so if you're not following this right now, that's okay. We'll do a specifics of programming Chia in another video. Some other examples of conditions include asserting that the coin is a certain age or higher, and that can be relative as well. You can assert that a signature exists inside of the aggregated signature. You can assert that other coins have made specific announcements, and you can make assertions that there is a fee of a certain value inside of your spend bundle. So what happens when a transaction is included in a block? The coin, the puzzle reveal, and the solution are all stored along with the single aggregated signature for that block. The new coins that are created based off the returned conditions are committed to the blockchain, but you should be cautious that farmers have access to your puzzle reveal and your solution. So you need to secure data using signatures, because otherwise a malicious actor might be able to change what your solution is. Here is a secure version of the piggy bank. Notice how puzzhash and new amount are now secure because there's a signature required from Alice's pub key of those values. So that last example looked pretty good, but I just want to pause so you can think about what you've seen. In that puzzle, we created a new coin with more value than the parent coin had. How does that work? Was it really necessary for us to hardcode Alice's pub key into the Chialisp? And how do we track the coins that this puzzle generates? Let's talk about amounts and creating new coins, and some fun that you can have with spend bundles. When you spend a coin, the only guarantee is that the puzzle code will run and that the coin will be destroyed. When you spend a coin, you can choose to create a new coin, or multiple new coins, or no new coins at all. This is done with the create new coin condition. When you create new coins, the amounts don't have to equal those of the parent. Instead, the accounting is done at the scope of the spend bundle. So as long as the spend bundle amount is not printing new money, then you can play loosey-goosey games inside. This opens up some cool tricks. Here's an example of how Alice could put 50 mojo into her piggy bank coin. Let's suppose she has a standard puzzle coin with amount 200 and the piggy bank coin with amount 300. She could spend the standard puzzle coin and create a coin with 150, so that there is 50 mojo now floating around in the ether to be claimed, and with her piggy bank coin, she could spend that and list the new amount as 350. And this would be valid because inside of that spend bundle, the amounts add up. Now, you may be wondering if having 50 mojo floating around in the ether is dangerous. But remember, we have an aggregated signature that staples these transactions together. The aggregated signature cannot be separated unless you know one of the individual signatures that composes it. Tricks like this with internal spend bundle accounting and aggregate signatures enable a lot of really powerful things in the Chia ecosystem. So it's worth taking your time to understand them. And finally, I want to spend a little bit of time discussing the ways that you can track and spend coins. So when we created our piggy bank coin, there would have been a unique puzzle hash based on Alice's pub key being inserted into there. To see our coin, we can simply search for that puzzle hash on the Block Explorer, and we'll find our coin ID. Knowing the coin ID and the puzzle reveal, we can create a spend bundle JSON object and submit it to the network using an API call from our full node. We can then see if this spend goes ahead using the Block Explorer and continue to interact with our coin this way. This approach is fast to get started, but limited because it requires a lot of manual lookups. If you want to have a more advanced method of tracking and spending coins, you can build a wallet. Wallets are what we use internally. They track your public keys, your puzzle hashes, and your coins. They're easy to add new and niche specific features. They connect to the wallet state manager and can remember information between sessions. You can program them to have a memory about the state of coins, for example, where your chessboard is up to. And you can automate a lot of the annoying parts. The downside is that we don't have very much tooling to make them at the moment. This is something that we're actively in development of, and it's not practical in the long run to have every single kind of smart contract have its own GUI built into our wallet. This concludes the high-level overview of Chia applications. For more information on specifics, you should check out the following videos that will go more into depth in a number of these areas. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in a future video.